Of course, they began to make the opportunity happen where they could actually take this desk home. She was wanting her dad to do something that he really wanted, but she was wanting him to do it sooner than what he was wanting to do it right then. And 1 John 5:14 says, this is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. One of the things for you and I is that we approach God with a lot of wants. We approach God with a lot of scenarios. We approach God with a lot of things that we actually maybe even put stipulations on God and say, look, God, there's some things I need, but here's the parameters by which I want you to do it. I want you to kind of take care of everything I want, but I only want you to do it A, B, or C. And God's kind of like, well, I don't really work on your parameters, but okay, go ahead and keep flapping your gums all you want to. I work on my parameters. And depending upon how you and I approach God, we might be able to change what God has decided to do. Stay with me. The daughter's request was heartfelt. This was something she really wanted. This was something she wanted to take this desk home today, because she wanted to use it today, whatever. So God is also looking at our sincerity. God is looking at our desires, whether or not they're sincere, whether or not they're fake, whether or not they're just to say something, whether or not we're trying to tell other people once we ask God for something and he grants it, that we can brag about it, or whatever that it might be. God is looking at our sincerity. James 5:16 says, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. The fervency of our prayers, the intensity of our prayers, the desires of what we're trying to do and how we're approaching God actually affects the outcome of what's taking place, because God hears the prayers of his people. This isn't something that you and I are just throwing things out and God's really not listening and he's kind of just playing around and whenever he decides to do something, he's just going to do it. No, God actually hears our petitions. Unlike me, 40 years of not listening to Kathy. I'm just being straight. This is a transparency place right here, right? And she's not in the room right now, so we're all good. You and I need to realize that God hears what's happening in our lives. Most of all, the Father is moved by his daughter's asking and the way she's putting it out. This dad is moved because his daughter called him daddy. She's his child. He wanted to do the best for her. He heard her. And because you and I are God's children, God hears our requests. God hears our prayers. Does he always answer them the way we want? No. Do we always get everything exactly the way we want it? No. But God hears our prayers. God hears us. He loves us. And he loves hearing from us. And this is what I want to talk to you about today. He even tells us what to ask for. He tells us to ask, thy kingdom come. Many of us are satisfied with just mere mediocrity. When we go into the great house of God, we go into this place, and we have a bag full of requests. We want a better job. We want a better salary. We want a better house. We want better schools for our kids. We want nicer clothes. We want other things. We want peace. We want no drama. We want less taxes, a better president, a worse president, a better vacation. We want to get better at our hobby. All the bags of things that we have carried around, all of these requests that we're taking to God, God is hearing all of these things, and this is kind of how we're just kind of pouring it out to him. It's like a drive-through prayer. Hey, God, give me two better job offers and a chocolate Oreo shake. Well, everything goes better with Oreo shakes. You gotta leave that in there, right? That's kind of how we approach God. The intensity and the fervency of our prayers are kind of lackluster. The confidence by which we approach the throne of grace is kind of feeble. quit doing a drive-by on him. Because let me tell you something. I don't want God to speak back to me like you hear in the drive-by. I want to hear God's voice clearly. I don't want this whole thing to be some kind of... And listen, they have really, I looked this up, they actually have places you can drive through and actually get prayer. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the way you and I go into the throne room of God. How we approach God with our requests. We just take all this stuff that we've got in these bags and we just say, okay, God, you want it, you got it. Oh, I like this one. More money. I want to look 10 years younger. God said, well, that's not going to work. We want to go and approach God in this kind of complacent way. It doesn't cut it. This is how you're going to approach God. This is how you and I are going to get things done. Here we are before the King of Kings. Here we are before the Alpha and the Omega. Here we are before the I Am. Here we are before our great God. A place in which we've covered our mouths and we've been quiet and silent because of His holiness. Here we are. The first thing we do when we stand in His presence, we say, God, please fix my car. God, please get rid of this thing that's on my leg. God, do something for me. Do something that I need. How do we start this prayer with God? How do we start? Do we talk to God when we first kneel before Him? We say, God, I got to talk to you about my water heater. It's not working. I got to talk to you, God. Where I'm living, I got no trees, and I got one air conditioner. So what are we going to do? When we stand before God, what are we going to do? Hey, our needs matter to Him. Our needs do matter. They do matter. He does care about the things that we need. God does care about that. But where are we going to start? This is what He tells us, Matthew 6, 9 and 10. When you pray, pray like this. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come. This is what He tells us. Thy kingdom come. When you and I begin to pray in this way, this serious way, this honest way, guess what you do? You begin to actually, on your part, invite God into your world. You've actually now asked God, God, I want you to come and invade my space. God, I want you to actually come right where I'm at, in the middle of my junk, in the middle of my stuff, in the middle of this whole guess what happens? God shows up. God comes down. And He comes to our place. I don't know about you. I've been a Christian for a long time. And there are times in my life where I've had to go and get to this place where I've actually had to tell God, listen, I've had to make a mess of this whole thing. A complete mess. I need you to come down here. I'm not coming to you to ask you to do anything crazy. I just need you to fix me. Because I'm a mess. I'm broken. I'm hurting. I'm not doing things right. I need you, God, not to do anything else, but I need you, God, to fix me. Because, folks, there's nothing that can change your circumstances greater than when God changes your heart. It changes everything. I want God to be in my family. I want God to be in my fear. years. I want God to be in my marriage. I want God to be in my heart. I want God to sit at the throne of my heart. Folks, let me give you a true doctrinal thought. Every one of us, when we're talking about this and we're talking about God living inside of us, the whole idea that, of course, that there's not a literal person inside of us, that would be weird. Okay? This is spiritually speaking. But every one of us has this inner part of us, we call it the heart, the seat of our conscience, the place in which the Holy Spirit of God, where God resides. And at that place, there's a throne. And one of the great things about that happens in this dynamic is that when people really change, what happens is they finally get off the throne of their heart. And they allow the God of this universe to sit there, to live there, to reside there. One of the things that you and I do is we want God to do everything else. We want Him to take care of all the exteriors. We want Him to take care of all the things that are on the outside. We kind of heard about this last night, that every one of us has something that's going on the outside and something that's going on the inside. And we want God to fix all the outside. That's why we're out there and we're running and we're doing and we're not eating and we're eating and you guys are on this diet and that diet and every kind of diet. Listen, even that part is really simple. If you eat less than you move, you lose weight. Yeah, write it down, write it down, write it down. It's very simple. I should have actually had it put on there, right underneath the throne part. But it's really simple. Calorie intake minus movement equals weight loss or weight gain. Okay? The whole idea is this is what we're trying to do. We're trying to fix the outside. We want everything to last.
India to Ethiopia. He's the most powerful man
on the face of the earth as far as men go in this particular time. If he even twitched an eye, he didn't like you, you would be dead. And so, in this whole situation, we have another guy, kind of his right-hand man, or the guy who basically wanted to be his right-hand man, but really, in his heart, he kind of even wanted to take over. His name is Haman. And Haman was a dirtbag. And Haman did not like this other guy in the story, and he's a Jewish man, and his name is Mordecai. One of the things that we got to know is that Esther is also Jewish. That's kind of hidden underneath some of these things. And Mordecai even told her, you need to keep all of this stuff kind of quiet. So anyway, to make a long story short, as we're going through this whole scenario, this guy Haman wants everybody to bow down to him. And so because Mordecai will not bow down to him, and he realizes who he is, that he's Jewish, that Haman sets it up to where he gets a hold of Xerxes, and he gets Xerxes to make this decree, and basically they've set a date, and they're basically going to wipe out all the Jews. They're going to kill them all. So Mordecai's trying to talk to Esther about this. He's trying to tell her, and of course, he's kind of already told her to keep it a secret who you are, but now he's trying to use her influence as the queen. He's trying to use her influence to go and to talk so he won't have everybody killed. And so as we get into this story, and as we get into this part, here's what happens. Esther tells him, she says in Esther chapter 4, verse 11, she said, "Hey, Mordecai, check it out. No man or woman may go to the king in the inner courtyard without being called. There is only one law about this. Anyone who enters must be put to death unless the king holds out his gold scepter. Then that person may live." And she says to him, "I have not been called into the inner courtyard in 30 days. And see, that shows you how many women that Xerxes had. He basically had so many women that he was just calling other women into his place and into the palace and all these other people, that even the queen didn't even have an audience with her husband for over a month. And so Mordecai tells her, "Just because you think you live in the king's palace, don't think that out of all the Jewish people, you alone will escape. If you keep quiet at this time, someone else will help and save the Jewish people, but you and your father's family will all die. And who knows, Esther? Who knows? You may have been chosen queen for such a time as this." Esther chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. And so, what does Esther do? Chapter 5, verse 1, it says, "So Esther puts on her royal robes and stood in the inner courtyard of the king's palace, facing the king's halls." So Esther decides, you know what? I'm just going to give it a whirl. I'm going to see what happens. I mean, 50-50, either he holds the scepter out or he doesn't. She even makes a statement, "If I perish, I perish. If I die, I die." And so as she's standing out there, Xerxes sees her. And the Bible tells us in Esther that Xerxes looks at her and it says that he is pleased. And he holds out the golden scepter. And as he holds out the golden scepter, she takes her hand and she places it on it. And so he finds favor with her. And so what she does is she begins this, and I don't know, you might want to call it manipulation, I don't know, because really nothing's happened. She begins to have two banquets for Xerxes and for Haman, the two really bad guys in the story. But Haman's the devil, Mordecai's kind of like the Holy Spirit, Esther's kind of like us, and Xerxes is the king. He's the king. And so Mordecai's telling Esther, "You need to do something." Esther does it, and so now she has these banquets. After the second banquet, Xerxes says, "Hey, why don't you just ask me what's going to happen, that they're going to annihilate all these people. There's going to be people from 127 countries that are going to be killed because of what's been set in motion. And he asks her, who's the murderer? And she points to Haman, and he says, he's the one. So this is what takes place. What takes place in this story is immediately the gallows that Haman had set up for Mordecai, he gets set there and he gets hung and killed. Mordecai, who is basically kind of relegated to prison and kind of put out of the way, Mordecai takes Haman's job. And all of these people are saved. So what does this whole story mean to you and me? I'll tell you. Glad you asked. I'm glad you're actually awake, really. I'm really glad. Let me tell you what it means to you and I. All right? Like Esther, you and I have been pulled from obscurity. Like Esther, you and I have been pulled from our places of addiction, from our areas of sin, from our places where nobody knew who we were, to the places to where we were really not known by anyone. And God has given us a name above all names. God has set within us something that nothing can take away from us, that neither height nor depth nor principalities or things in heaven or things in earth or things to come can take away from us. God has set in motion some things in our hearts and lives that the enemy cannot steal away from us. He's taken us from this place, and he's taken us from the miry clay, and he set us on the rock to stay. Just like Esther, you and I were people who had no home. We were people who were nothing, and God has made us something. Not that anybody else has said we're something, but God has said we are something. How do I know that? He sent his son to die for you. That's how I know it. He sent his son to give his life for you. Just like Esther, you and I have been taken from nowhere, and we've been given a place in the palace. We have an opportunity to go to the throne room of God and to speak with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Like Esther, you and I have had these old clothes taken off, and we're actually now clothed in a robe of righteousness. You and I now have these old filthy rags that were our sins, and God has clothed us in his glory. You and I, like Esther, have been taken and given an opportunity to make a request before the king. Just like this little girl was given an opportunity to make a request to her father to change this whole thing and to bring this desk to her. As that whole story unfolded, what happened was that somebody found out about it, and they came and grabbed that desk, and they went and took it off, and they painted it. When they brought it back, it was completely covered in angels. Can I tell you something? That when you and I pray to our great God, we pray that the kingdom come, that our God comes, and the whole host of heaven comes with him. The whole host of heaven comes to our aid. When you and I are in the lowest places of our lives, and God has the opportunity to change us and go to the places where we are, right in the middle of our sin, right in the middle of our stupidity, right in the middle of our addictions, right in the middle of all the things that we just don't have an answer for. Because I promise you, people have asked me, why have you done the things you've done? And I just give the duh. I don't know. And I don't know why God still loves me, but he does. God gives me an opportunity to be like Esther. He gives me an opportunity to speak to the heart of the king. He gives me an opportunity to speak to the heart of the king. As the group comes back, I'm going to ask you a couple of things today. What about your heart? Why are you here at this place before me? If you were to die right now, would you go to heaven? Are you in a right relationship with God? Are you able to come to God and speak to Him right now and not have a whole bunch of baggage that you have to get rid of first? When you were going to talk to God at the very beginning, how would you start? What would you do? I'm just sharing with you and telling you today that our great God loves you no matter what. He loves you right where you are. He loves you from wherever you've been. But the one great promise that He makes that I'm so thankful for is He promises not to leave us that way. He changes us forever and for eternity. So today, you have an opportunity, as they're going to play, you have an opportunity to come and have places you can kneel. There are people here that will pray with you.